My name is Bill Cavanaugh. I'm the director of the Center for World Catholicism and Intercultural Theology here. We're a research center based on the Church in the Global South. And the people that really need to be thanked for putting this on are Karen Kraft, Francis Salano, Anna Kreutz, the staff of the center. We've got lots of events. I know many of you have seen you at events before. We have lots of events, and some of the sheets are in front of you. Our next Brazil-related event, we have Marcelo Timoteo da Costa Silva here with us. Did I get that right? Did I get all your names in the right order?
Not exactly, but...
Okay. We'll just call him Marcelo. He's our historian from Brazil who's here with us for 4 months. He's going to be giving a talk on May 7th on liberation theology and St. Francis. So please be aware of that. We'd love to see you there as well. But now I want to introduce Cathy Elias, who doesn't need a whole lot of introduction for this crowd. I think Cathy's a good friend of the center. We're an interdisciplinary center, and it's so wonderful when the disciplines are not just the prosaic ones, the history and theology and philosophy and political science, but when we branch out into music, it's always a delight. And so we're really happy to have Cathy here. She's a professor in the Department of Music. She studied at Juilliard. She got her PhD from the University of Chicago. She has interests, I guess, scholarly specialties in Franco-Flemish music in the 16th century and Italian Renaissance music. But she also does Brazil and the Beatles. So, of course, on the Beatles. So she has this wide, wonderful range. Gave a terrific talk at our conference on Dom Helder Camara last November, I guess it was. And so please join me in welcoming Cathy.
Okay, so today I will situate three Catholic masses in their historical context and illustrate how they remain important artifacts that witness the suffering and the history of minority groups, the oppressed, and the poor in Brazil. What I would like to do, though, before I start is because this is quite an eclectic crowd, so I think what I want to do before I start is go over a bunch of things that half of you will know, so you'll have 6 minutes of being bored, and some of you, it'll help you situate the talk so I don't say things that you don't understand. So, the issue with these masses, before I even start, is, I have to go over here, so you have a little, you can listen to 2 minutes of this and then we'll talk about the problem, and then I'll introduce some terms. So this is the Kyrie of the ordinary of the mass. And you will see immediately what the problem is going to be for some people. It's very serious in the throat. Wanted you to hear a little bit of that. So the problem is that in all three of these masses, they're going to be heavily troped to tell the story of Brazil and problems that happen. So before we go on, I want to make sure that everyone in the room knows a bunch of very simple sort of things. So the Council of Trent was very important because it kind of cleaned the house of abuses and it enforced liturgical uniformity, and it banned anything like this. Tropes were banned. The problem is the liturgy didn't really get revisited until Vatican II. So we had 400 years pretty much of sticking with the same sort of rules and uniformity. One of the big rallying points of Vatican II was the church wanted to rethink its position in the modern world, become relevant to diverse cultures, and connect with the largest Catholic community, which is Latin America. So a couple of very important documents that came out of the Council of the Vatican II is bring the church up to date, reform sacred liturgy, modify liturgy to incorporate individual needs of diverse cultural groups. The second document, it says dogmatic constitution on the church, focus on people of God. 40 times it says the expression people of God. So take it from the bottom up instead of the top down. So it was kind of a new way of looking at things. And the pastoral constitution on the church in the modern world, again, put a lot of emphasis on culture. Don Elder Camara and other bishops saw all sorts of problems after Vatican II. They viewed the church as very Western. There was sort of a complete lack of presence among the poor. Bring the laity into the mainstream of the church, meet with the poor, read the Bible, and empower them. These support two of the main themes of Vatican II, option for the poor and the people of God. The logos and the practice will be centered soon in liberation theology. This is an encyclical, so this is written by Paul VI. Preference for the marginalized is of great concern to the church. As you see, all of these are focusing on the fact that we have paid no attention for a long time on the poor. And one of the most important bishops' conferences in 1968, it produced three documents, poverty, peace, and justice. And all of these address problems that were specific to Latin America of poverty and injustice and people being held down because of lack of money and no one paying any attention to it. So very simply, since we're going to throw out the word liberation, you know, theology of liberation or liberation theology, it was a way of doing theology from the perspective of the poor and marginalized. So we go from the poor out. And understanding through the study of the Bible. And what happened is they formed small groups, as I said, these base communities, where people got together and they talked about the Bible, but they tried to relate it to their situations and what was going on in their lives. It's sort of theologies. It's not one theology. It unfolds over time. The idea is through reflection, looking back at the oppression of the poor, marginalized by social and political conditions that were beyond their control. Gutierrez was the kind of big guy who kind of put it all together, and he said the unique problem of Latin American Christianity, not the non-believer, but the non-person, one who has been dehumanized through poverty, oppression, and domination. So the masses we're going to talk about, two of them take place during the period of the military dictatorship. The military dictatorship, the idea was that they were going to protect Western democracy against communism. Opponents of the regime were subversive and they were considered communists. No matter what you said, if you opposed them, you were a communist. So Catholics opposing the dictatorship were considered communists. Here are three very big players. Leonardo Boff, I think he was silenced for a year. Don Elder Camara was not allowed to mention his name in the newspapers. And Don Piero Casadoliga, I think they tried to kill him many, many times, so he had a really hard time. He is still alive, but in very bad shape. So, to sum it up, to give you the idea, this is very famous for all of you who know it, Elder Camara said, basically, I can't win. When I give food to the poor, they call me a saint. When I ask why the poor have no food, they call me a communist. So he felt pretty much doomed from the start. I did want to say I thought it was quite cute that when I went to visit his quarters in Recife, I noticed a picture of St. Vincent of Paul hanging there on the wall. That is his bedroom. So I thought that was... Okay, so the military dictatorship, just to talk about it very quickly, is in 1964, the military deposed the elected president. In 1967, things became really bad. Civil rights were suspended, all kinds of censorship. There was a lot of tortures and killings. And many people left the country, had to leave the country. And the 70s, things got a little better when our masses are going to be performed, and by 1985, they restored democracy fully. So let's go back and look at so that's just a little idea to kind of set you up. So these are the three masses I will discuss. The first mass, the Missa da Terra Semalis, was performed in 1979 for the Year of the Martyrs in Missois. The text, poetry mixed with the Roman Rite, is by Pietro Tierra and the well-known liberation theologian Don Pietro Casadoliga. The tropes recount and apologize for the injustice perpetrated against the Indians and by the colonists and by the church. The second mass, a Missa dos Quilombos, performed in Recife in 1981 against Vatican orders, was commissioned by Don Elder Camara, who at the time was the Archbishop of Recife, a strong believer in liberation theology. The tropes by Casadoliga and Tierra describe injustices and sufferings of Brazilian slaves and affirm their dignity. The music for this mass was composed by Milton Nascimento. The last mass I want to talk to is what we call it 2EU. was composed by Marlui Miranda, and it was composed for the fourth centenary of the death of Padre José de Anchieta, the Apostle of Brazil. The Roman Rite is translated into Tupi, and the tropes are in several Amerindian languages. Marlui used melodies from various Brazilian Indian nations to celebrate the culture of the first Brazilians and to pay homage to an extraordinary priest who devoted 40 years of his life working and living with the Tupi Indians. Both Pope Paul's encyclical on the development of peoples, 1967, which I mentioned earlier, and the second Latin American Episcopal Conference in 1968 made explicit the role of the church, that is, to embrace the people and help them overcome historical patterns of oppression. In the encyclical, Paul VI castigates colonialism and reiterates the church's preference for the poor. He quotes St. Ambrose, "The earth belongs to everyone, not just the rich." The Pope argues that people in wretched poverty not only lack food, but are also deprived of dignity. They are denied religious rights, they are denied political rights, and all social aspirations for a better life. This injustice, I quote, cries out for God's attention. At the 1968 Latin American Bishops Conference, the clergy argue that the poor are oppressed economically by the social system and politically by the regimes that sustain these unjust and unequal structures. They need to be, quote, liberated, and the church must help them in this process. And then I quote one of the priests there. "A deafening cry pours from the throats of millions of men asking their pastors for a liberation that reaches them from nowhere else." These ideas further developed into a coherent and political ideology, liberation theology. With its option for the poor and explicit responsibility to fight for justice on earth, liberation theology generated social and political activism, popular involvement, and strong resistance to dictatorships and bad governments, and the conservative factions of the Catholic Church. This was true in Brazil under the military dictatorship. Members of the Catholic hierarchy, in opposition to the Vatican, were directly and actively engaged in the resistance to the military. For example, Dom Pedro Casadáliga tried to protect the Indians in the region he was working in at great personal risk. He watched several of his own priests be shot in front of him. He was not shot, but he watched women be abused and beat up. I mean, it was very bad. Don Elder Camara was an elegant voice for the poor, but the military banned any reference to him in the media, so you could not mention his name. This conflict was inevitable, in Don Elder Camara's words, as I said earlier, but it's worth repeating. "When I feed the poor, they call me a saint. When I ask why the poor have no food, they call me a communist." Both the Missa da Terra Semales and the Missa dos Quilombos were conceived in the spirit of a protest against past and present oppression. Although composed during the waning period of the dictatorship, realizing the performance involved a serious struggle with both the government and the Vatican. So let me now jump to... Okay. The first performance of the Missa da Terra Semales was at the Cathedral de Sé in São Paulo on April 22, 1979. But why is the Mass called the Land Without Evil, Missa da Terra Semales, and why did liberation theologians feel an affinity for this Mass? Let me go back and give you a little history now. The first chroniclers of Brazil, who thought of the Indians as godless, wrote of a strange Tupi custom. Unexpectedly and often, the Indians would migrate to a new location. We now know that they were searching for a type of utopia, a land without evil, a place where no pain or suffering, there isn't any of that, with food growing everywhere, with everyone singing and dancing, and where no one would die, a type of heaven on earth. In essence, these migrations were pilgrimages to a holy land by non-people of a colonial society. The idea of the land without evil resonated with liberation theologians. One should strive for the kingdom of God, even if not fully realized here and now on earth. Dom Pedro writes a poetic motivation for why he thought this Mass was important and why it was good that they had written it. Here in Brazil in 1978 was the year of the martyrs. This was to honor three Jesuits who were killed during trying to catechize Indians in Rio Grande do Sul. 350 years ago. Brazilian Indian Missionary Council and the church decided one should commemorate not just them, but also the death of thousands of Indians sacrificed by the Christian empires of Spain and Portugal. They were all martyrs for the Indian cause. They all share the cross amongst all of them. The missionaries dying for Christ and the Indians massacred in the name of Christ and the emperor. The mass is an apology by the church for the injustices done to the Amerindians and a tribute to the marginalized people living with institutional organized violence today. Its extensive poetic tropes are incorporated into the liturgy. In these tropes, the church apologized for the cruelties and now declares itself in solidarity with the oppressed and massacred native communities in all of Latin America. Bishop Casadaliga gives a long justification for why the penitential attitude of this mass is important. And at this point, a lot of people are not considering this a mass. There's a big debate that we really shouldn't be considered a mass. I believe in the mission that was Christ's vocation, that is, according to Vatican II, the essence of the church. And I feel the heir to yesterday's missionaries, heir to their sins and to their virtues. The we of the penitential memory of this mass is ecclesiastic we, a collective we. What kind of Christian can deny and not assume responsibility for the mistakes committed by the Church of Jesus yesterday and today, even if they were committed with the best intentions? How can we assume responsibility if we not try to repair mistakes? Men err and Christians are still human. The Mass follows the Roman Rite, but because it includes extensive tropes, a big objection of the Vatican, it is often labeled a cantata. They don't like that. All right. So here, basically, you have on the far right the big outline of the Catholic Mass, and here you have on the left basically what is in this Mass. So this Mass is, and in the middle we have, you can kind of see the whole chart. Okay. Don Casadaliga defends the Mass as a genuine and authentic Mass, the kind of Mass that should be celebrated today, not in spite of the strong non-liturgical content, but exactly because of it. He continues, I believe that the Missa da Terra Semalis is orthodox. The Mass respects the liturgical scheme. It is a musical and recited text that translates and transports into a native Indian inspiration the real celebration of the Eucharist. The Mass aims to convey the spirit and the meaning, but in a very specific manner, embracing the culture and the devotion of the Indians. And I will provide a few examples and give you a few ideas of what the tropes look like. But these are pretty wild, so you can kind of understand a little bit why they didn't like it. In the name of the Father and of all peoples. But take a look at some of these things. In the name of the Son that makes all of us men brothers. In the blood mixed with all bloods. In the name of the Alliance of Liberation. In the name of light of all culture. In the name of love that is all love. In the name of the land without evil. So they're going to go on a long sort of thing here. And it was, this is kind of the Indians complaining. I was at peace with me and the earth, and we violated you. This is now the totus, this is now the supposedly the priest saying this. And we violated you with the edge of our sword, with the fire of the musket. We burned thy peace. We missionized you, unfaithful to the gospel, digging into your life, the sword of a cross. Bells of good news in a death toll. Unfaithful to the gospel in the incarnate word, give you a message, the outsider culture. Then we branded you with a baptism imposed, a tag of human livestock, blasphemy of baptism, violation of grace and denial of Christ. I was one of millions of people alive, millions and millions of human people, millions of living images of the living God. And we decimated you, carriers of death, missionaries of nothing. So you can imagine that this caused a problem. So let's listen to a little bit of the music. And this is only a small passage. I mean, the whole thing, you know, I translated the whole thing, but it's obviously that would be too much. So this is almost more of a folk type thing. These tunes are from all over South America. From a live performance. Okay, so basically throughout this entire mass, there are these extensive tropes, which of course caused some disagreement among many people. Okay, let me get past that now. Okay, so what I'd like to do now is study the Misa Dos Quilombos by Milton Nascimento. Some of you may know him because he is very famous and has been to the United States, and he's worked with Paul Simon and people like that. Milton Nascimento is one of the greatest singers and composers of Brazilian popular music. When his mother, a maid, died, the people who employed her were glad to raise Milton as their own. As a black child growing up in a loving white family, questions of race did not escape him. Milton is called the Portuguese troubadour. He combines many styles, dance tunes from bars, slave hymns, Gregorian chants, and Brazilian folk songs, packaging them in jazz and rock-inspired idioms. His music is informed in a profound way by his having grown up in a small town in Minas Gerais, where he absorbed the music of the churches, of the religious processions, of the local folk traditions, as well as mysticism, hopes, and suffering of the local people. This mass is both a protest and an apology for the injustices committed against blacks throughout Brazilian history. It is commissioned by Don Elder Camara, working in the slums of Recife. Like the Missa da Terra Sem Males, the poetic tropes were written by Piero Tierra and Dom Pedro Casadaliga. The Missa dos Quilombos celebrates the death and resurrection of the African Brazilian people in the death and resurrection of Christ. So I wanted to find out what Quilombos is. Quilombos were settings established by runaway slaves and by freeborn natives during the colonial period. The most famous quilombo was Palmares, which lasted for most of the 17th century as a large, self-sustaining political community. The last chief of Palmares was Zumbi, and he was killed after the main city was conquered by a large Portuguese-Brazilian force. During the colonial period, the Catholic Church tolerated slavery as part of the Brazilian social structure. However, as the 16th century priest Padre Anchieta raised his voice to protest against the plight of the Indians, the great Portuguese-Brazilian writer of the 17th century, the Jesuit Antonio Vieira, spoke eloquently in support of the human treatment of slaves. So I will let you look at a couple of these passages as we go along. Are these not sons of the same Adam and Eve? Were these souls not redeemed by the blood of the same Christ? These bodies, are they not born, and do they not die like our bodies? Do they not breathe the same air? Are they not under the same sky? Are they not worn by the same sun? He has these very passionate speeches. I'll give you a couple of highlights. But what theology is there, or could there be, that would justify the lack of humanity and the gruesomeness of the exorbitant punishments with which these slaves were treated? Treated, I said, but the word is too short for the meaning that it contains, or that it hides. Tyrannized, I should have said, or martyred, for they hurt these miserable ones, marked, sealed, cut to pieces, with salt rubbed onto them. The subject up to bigger excess that I will not speak of, but that deserve the name of martyrdom rather than punishment. They are cruelly whipped. They are cruelly whipping the miserable slave. At each whip, he screams, "Jesus, Maria, Jesus, Maria." Yet the reverence due of these two names is not enough to bring out piety in a man who calls himself a Christian. This would be, of course, the landowner. And how do you want that they hear you, these two names, when at the time of your death you clamor for them? But these claims that thou hearest not, know that God hears them. So these are some very, he wrote a lot of speeches, these are some passages, some very inflamed ones. Few abolitionists have written more elegantly. Vieira did not go as far as to fight slavery. It is debatable to what extent his actions were conditioned by his problems with the Inquisition, or the perception that such an idea, freedom, was far from being able to happen. So he had slaves himself. He had a plantation, he had his own slaves. Hopefully he treated them the way he said he did. Vieira tried to protest slaves against cruelty and attempted to console them by equating their plight with that of Christ, saying their suffering was a true imitation of Christ and would earn them salvation in the afterlife. Why? Because on earth they were living in hell. So surely, if they were obedient, heaven would be the next step, because there could not be two hells. Basically the idea was you're living right now in hell, so you have to go to heaven. Not like a lot of consolation, actually. Okay. Centuries later, so go ahead, take all the abuse, you'll be fine. So centuries later, Don Pietro Casadaliga and Pierre de Tierra were more demanding in the poetic tropes for their Marian Mass. Well, let's look at the outline of this Mass. And as you can see, it's got all the kind of standard parts. Okay. So they were not content with promises for the afterlife. So they were saying, oh, enough of this afterlife stuff. Supporters of liberation theology, they believed in the kingdom of God on earth and demanded not only equality in the present, but an apology for crimes of the past. With the support of Don Mel de Camera, the first performance took place in Recife on November 20th, 1981, though he was told not to do it. But he did. And this is just a picture. It's really kind of a shame. I took this picture in December. This is the cathedral, and this would be the main place. And they had roughly 8,000 people apparently showed up for when they performed this Mass. This, unfortunately, now is probably one of the most dangerous areas of Recife. The cab driver drove right into the middle of the square and wouldn't let me alone, said, no, I'm staying with you. So I was like, okay, well. After having been in Africa, I thought, oh, this looks like Africa. We're good. And he's like, no, you're not good. You're not good. Definitely not good. So, at this time and throughout the dictatorship, the figure of Zumbi and the movement of Palmares were viewed as symbols not only of the fight against slavery, but as universal symbols of the struggle for freedom, in particular, also freedom from the military dictatorship. Thus, Milton's work proclaimed a message of resistance to the oppression and belief in the final victory of the human spirit. The Missa dos Quilombos is an affirmation of the worth of the blacks and a demand for an apology from the church, all within the context of an Easter Mass, a Mass that is a statement of suffering and resurrection and therefore forgiveness and faith in the future. Milton combined African-style percussion of candomblé with the liturgy of the Mass. This was a factor, probably a big factor in the prohibition of the Mass by the Vatican, which had long battled against syncretism, the mixing of candomblé elements with the Roman rite. So we can look at a little bit of this. And you heard a teeny bit of this when you walked in. So here's just to give you some ideas of the music. Things like this were objections in the name of the God of all names, and then they start naming other gods. So they didn't like this too much. These were the kind of things that they were a little bit like irritated about, to say the least. I believe translated the English for that. Thank you.
nome do Filho Jesus, nosso irmão, que nasceu moreno da raça de Abraão.
So it gives you a little idea of the sound, and what I'll do is...
Em nome do Espírito Santo, bandeira...
Now it stopped. Okay, so... One way to stop it. Okay, so this is what you heard a little bit about. This is kind of like my favorite movement. So this is the one you heard at the beginning. So this is exactly what the Council of Trent said. No more of this. No more of this. Because they were putting so much stuff into the Mass. But I actually looked up the rules now. And you can't put some stuff in the Kyrios. Probably not this. So these drums are associated with conflict, so I'm going to... This Mass, this one again, it's fun to look at these prior texts. They're very interesting. All right, so the third Mass I wanted to discuss is really very different. Both of these Masses were kind of an apology, explaining all the bad things that went on. But Miranda's Mass is more kind of like a celebration. She's basically celebrating Padre Anchieta. He is particularly interesting because he basically spent, as I said, 40 years nonstop with the 2P. So he never left. He was quite sick. He had terrible back problems and all kinds of problems. He got in a lot of fights with the church, with Nobrega and people like that, because he didn't want to push the Indians too hard. So he started educating the small children. He would let them go to school nude, and they would say, they don't have any clothes on. He was like, you know, that's okay. It'll all work out. And so he had three things he just wanted them to stop. He didn't want them to sleep around with a lot of different people, but he had a very particular reason for that, not just because he thought that was immoral. It's because what happened in the Tupi tribes is if you were with someone and you were pregnant, and then you decided to be with someone else, then when the baby was born, you just killed it, buried it alive, and the new man did not want it. And there's a wonderful, touching story in the archives of Anchieta there, and suddenly he sees them burying the baby alive, and he's like shocked. And he runs over, and he drags the baby out, and they explain to him, we don't want it because this is my new partner. And he cleans the whole baby off and says, well, then I'll raise it as my own. And he immediately takes the baby back and lives a couple of years and then unfortunately dies. So he had a real affection for the Indians. He wasn't just there. He had a real affection. He learned the Tupi really well. He wrote plays for them. He wrote a lot of texts that actually during this period even got set to music. But so let's talk a little more about her idea. And as I said, the Pope, I kept saying, no one knows who Anchieta is, but the Pope just made him a saint, so I guess everyone should know who he is now. All right. So, Miranda's Mass, was written to commemorate the fourth centenary of the death of Padre José de Anchieta, a Spanish Jesuit, who was recently made a saint, as I said, by Pope Francis. Marlui was born in 1949 and moved to Rio de Janeiro in the early 70s, where she studied classical guitar and became a successful singer and performer of Brazilian popular music, working with celebrated musicians such as Milton Nascimento and Gilberto Gil. During this period, she began her research on music of the Indians of northern Brazil. She became an international figure with her first recording of Iu, Todos Los Sons, in 1995. So we will... Iu is an Indian word, means sound. So let me just hear. So this is basically what she did. Okay, it's gone over there. It means sound. Not only noise, but everything that is comprehended by hearing, from its beginning until it is finally understood. Marlui arranged melodies borrowed from different Brazilian Indian nations, keeping their original tone, the melodic and the rhythmic structure intact. She recontextualized them in modern arrangements as art songs. So she decided to not to just sing these like, you know, folkways records, to kind of turn them into little art songs. By the way, she gave the money back to the Indians. Okay, so here are a couple, I want to give you a couple of sounds. This one is a ceremonial dialogue for various feasts and encounters. I thought hearing them. So the melody's correct, the language's correct, and anything she adds in the background is hers. And I'll give you another one. Okay. EU, a Catholic mass, combines several languages in the title to reflect the different ethnic groups of Brazil coming together in one nation. And there we have it. You can take a look. So that's what each one of the words means in the title. And as I said, this mass basically commemorates the death of José de Anchieta 400 years earlier. Okay, so who was he very quickly? He was basically, Anchieta was Brazil's first poet and writer. That's often disputed because a lot of people say, no, Vieira is, but I'm going to say, yes, he is, because I think he is. Because they think of Vieira as such a fabulous, unbelievably phenomenal writer. But actually, he was doing it first, so. Anchieta is the first, I would say, first poet and writer, was an important influential figure. He not only founded the city of São Paulo, but also lived among the Indians, as I pointed out, for over 40 years, trying to protect them. As part of his missionary work, he transcribed many religious texts into the Tupi language. He was the first person to make a grammar. So he really wanted to learn their culture. He also wrote poetry, a catechism, and religious plays in the Indian language, and published the first grammar book in Tupi. His fondness for the Indians permeates all his writings. He also did things as he made plays where would be part would be in Portuguese, part would be in Tupi, and in part of his trying to do sort of a translation of Indian religion to Catholicism. For the centenary event in 1997, Marlui wanted to compose a work to celebrate Anchieta's memory by incorporating generally Brazilian elements with which to express his character and his personality. Marlui wanted to stress the ideals and values of contemporary Brazil and at the same time affirm the roots of the country. She thought that a mass would have the capacity to embrace the faith of the archetype and symbol of the evangelical soul of Brazil, and the music would represent the spirit of the Indians, the first owners of Brazil. Thus, the best way to honor Padre Anchieta was within the celebration of the Easter of Jesus Christ, that was the same idea of the last Mass, but making the liturgy both Roman and indigenous. In the Mass, Marlui introduces the Tupi language together with Catholic liturgy. Native rhythms, ritual songs, and familiar fragments of the Latin Rite are sung in a mixture of Tupi, both 16th century Tupi and modern Tupi. And the Mass for orchestra and voices performed with jazz musicians and indigenous South American players and vocalists unites diverse traditions all centered on the most human of supplications. Native Indian rhythms and ritual songs are defined within the Catholic liturgy. So let's look at an outline of hers. Now, I don't know why she should be a lot less controversial, because where the other Mass was example of syncreticism, this is really an example, I think, very clearly of enculturation. A lot of these are just directly Tupi, absolutely the standard sort of elements of the ordinary the Mass or the Mass in general, all parts. And basically, you know, she didn't add a lot of tropes. Only in certain occasions, which I'll show you, she added sort of Indian tunes. But a lot of it is just, you know, straight up. The Pater Nostra is the translation in Tupi by Anchieta. So this is a lot more straightforward and what she did. Okay, the use of diverse languages creates a polylingual spiritual conversation within a rich musical soundscape that is distinctively Brazilian, and is an embodiment of the ideal equality across religion and race. Okay. Marlui struggled with the realization of this work. For example, when imagining the mass, she asked herself, what would a specifically Indian Kyrie, Gloria, and the other parts of the Roman Catholic Mass sound like? And I quote her now. I thought of the difficult situation facing the 16th century Jesuits who needed to translate Christian concepts to the field of sacred indigenous ones. I thought of myself, however, as doing the inverse musical catechism, forcing myself to find a Kyrie, a Gloria, an introit, and so on that could find shelter in selected indigenous repertory. The central idea of the Mass is the contraposition of faiths. On one hand, the songs of the shamans, and on the other hand, the Christian verses of Padre Anchieta and the liturgical texts accommodated in the same compositional framework. The indigenous songs I have selected, this is her saying this, have a solemn lyrical nature, and therefore they dignify the Mass, and they are appropriate to be interpreted by a symphonic orchestra and chorus. Thus, the choice of such an ensemble seems pertinent to the idea of catechism and the conversion of Indians to a European religion. The ancestral Tupi language unifies the composition into a single whole. At the same time, the Mass separates us from Indian origins. We become nearer to them because part of the vocal interpretation is done in an ethnic manner, evoking the Indian people and their forgotten voices in the past of catechism. The Mass is a composition with a delicate equilibrium, in which I tried to make adequate the poetic sense of Indian languages. These melodies are light and as fragile as spirits that brought them through the world of dreams. It is on this fragile structure that the poems of Anchieta rest. So let's take a look. So, for example, So here's an example, basically, what she's going to do in the Kyrie. In the Kyrie, an Indian woman sings in the style mixing two faiths. And we have, at the same time, there's a Gregorian chant and a chant of nomination. So here they're going to kind of go back within the same thing. This is not as much, it's tropes, but it's really much more, a lot of it's also just translation. But let's listen to a little bit of this. So this has the least of, you know, kind of, you know, it doesn't have the big message like, you know. I mean, in the Missa da Terra Semalis, there are lines that are like, you took the cross and you sharpened it and you stabbed us in the heart to try to, you know, convert us. All that, I wonder why they wrote that. So all of that is missing in this particular Mass. So this is much more straight up celebration for him, celebration of the cultures, bringing it all together. So let's look at another one that's kind of interesting where we do have things come together. So here, the Agnus Dei, Latin text is sung in the background, and then you have a trope where I am going to the house of my brother to ask for light and help. And the second trope is that's an Indian tune. The second trope is Marlui's melody with lyrics by Anchieta in Tupi. We want to love you, I come to honor you, dancing in your house, and wash my soul to take away the blemishes of evil. So you kind of can see where the Council of Trent banned all this. Then we kind of eased up again, but... performed at the San Pablo Cathedral on June 8, 1997 as part of the 400th anniversary celebrations of Anchieta's death. In attendance at this mass were representatives of the city, of the state, of the federal government, of the clergy. Cardinal Arns, the Archbishop of San Pablo, had to give special permission because Tupi wasn't one of the accepted languages that you could sing the mass in, which he did. So he was a big help. And I'd like to kind of conclude with a couple of points. I just put this up there for fun. The three masses are important cultural artifacts representing a troubled yet important part of Brazilian history and of the role of the church in it. Composed in the spirit of liberation theology, they are an important step in recognizing, acknowledging, and asking forgiveness for the past for the wrongs committed by or with the help of the church, even if they were committed, as I said, with the best intentions. They are part of a process of healing and building a better future on affirmation of hope, faith, and belief. And there was a priest at the Don Elder Camera Conference who said he was here at the time of the, he was at the performance of the Missa dos Quilombos, and he was just saying that when it was the opposite. What happened is that this became such a powerful sense of healing, and people felt so good at this, so it didn't cause negative problems or people getting mad at the church, or which is what the Vatican was kind of thinking. I mean, Casadelica was supposed to go back to Rome and he just refused, because he knew once they got him in Rome what was going to happen. And it was, I think it was Cardinal Ratzinger at the time said, you better get back here. So he knew two things. One, if he went back, he would never be allowed back in Brazil, because they would never let him back. And two, he knew that he was in trouble. But the result was that really informed healing, so it was a very positive thing. People didn't turn away from the church. People were not negative. He said people were just so happy, you know, to kind of be together and kind of experience this whole thing. And now the thing with the masses, I mean, the title of the talk was Draw the Circle Ever Wider But Stay on the Page. I am actually making a little bit fun of a book by Father Mark Francis, the president of the Catholic Theological Union, but he's read this, so it's okay, because he wrote a book with a very similar title. So the point is, how far can you go before you're actually, you know, going away from the liturgy? Now, he's a little bit upset about these, if you just like someone else's point of view. He says, I'm a little upset because he says, I feel that they draw attention away from the Eucharist. But you can see that Don Elder Camara and Pietro Casadelica basically said, no, they didn't feel it did it at all. And honestly, it seems to me, a personal opinion, that maybe we should have special masses. You know, maybe we should have special masses that are of this nature. Maybe this isn't what you just do, you know, every third Sunday, but maybe having special masses where you do this sort of thing is very good. If you look up any of these masses, half the time they say they're cantata, because that just stops all the fighting. But these guys, you know, are saying no, these are masses. And remember, these were priests who wrote the text and bishops who approved the performances of these. Anchieta is someone that really needs to be explored more. He wrote a lot of plays, like many Jesuits, as I said, in multiple languages, which is probably why people run away from them, because they're probably kind of hard to deal with. So I'm going to stop here, and I want to say one thing about our new Pope. Clearly, he is kind of a product of this kind of background, and shares, obviously, some of the ideas of all of this, and really wants to, you know, bring things back. The big problem with Catholicism in Brazil is really people say, oh, everyone's going to be becoming evangelical. Well, the real problem is there aren't any priests. You know what I mean? If the priests aren't there, I don't think people in Brazil are turning away from Catholicism. I think people in Brazil are going where there is God or a church or something to go to. But I mean, there was such a shortage of priests that that basically a lot of people will just move and migrate to where there is someone to help them. So I would like to say thank you all, and if anyone else asks anything.